Hare Krishna, Sri Devi Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to our Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much, Mataji, for coming on the call and giving us this class. And thank you so much. It's been a long time we didn't hear from you. So I'll just start the screen share, Mataji, 1 second.
Thank you. Please accept my humble obeisances, dear Srimati, and all my dear God family. My humble obeisances to each and every one of you. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to our beloved Guru Maharaj. Oh, there I see Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu. Please accept my humble obeisances, my dear God brother. Thank you for being here with all of us. Wonderful to see both of you. I would really hope that I can see all my God family, but I guess we can wait till the end, you know, for the question answer session. So generally speaking, Guru Maharaj is speaking from the Chaitanya Charitamrita. So I thought we will do Bhagavad Gita today so that Guru Maharaj continues with that. And I chose this particular verse for a reason which I will explain. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dharati Swapadantikam Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So Bhagavad Gita, 14th chapter, is the three modes of material nature. And I chose this verse, number 20. It goes like this. Gunan etan atityatrin, dehi deha samudbhavan, janma mrityu jara dukhair, vimukto mritam ashnute. Word for word. Gunan, qualities, etan, all these, atitya, transcending, trin, three, dehi, the embodied, deha, the body, samudbhavan, produced of, janma, of birth, mrityu, death, jara, an old age, dukhai, the distresses, vimukta, being freed from, amritam, nectar, ashnute, he enjoys. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. When the embodied being is able to transcend these three modes associated with the material body, he can become free from birth, death, old age, and their distresses, and can enjoy nectar even in this life. Purport. How can one stay in the transcendental position, even in this body, in full Krishna consciousness, is explained in this verse. The Sanskrit word dehi means embodied. Although one is within this material body, by his advancement in spiritual knowledge, he can be free from the influence of the modes of nature. He can enjoy the happiness of spiritual life even in this body, because after leaving this body, he is certainly going to the spiritual sky. But even in this body, he can enjoy spiritual happiness. In other words, devotional service in Krishna consciousness is the sign of liberation from material entanglement. And this will be explained in the 18th chapter. When one is freed from the influence of the modes of material nature, he enters into devotional service. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. Now Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Srimate Chandramouli Swaminiti Namine Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunivadi Pashtyadishatarine. Now, when we come to Krishna consciousness, we often hear this, chant and be happy, chant and be happy, chant and be happy, and we think, I'm not happy yet. I have so many problems. I have so many stresses. I have so many worries. I have so many tensions. And people keep telling me to be happy, to be happy. But I'm not happy. But that's because we are very conditioned. And we have been associating with the modes of material nature for so long. So it almost seems, is it even possible to be happy? So many difficulties, you know, adhyatmika, adhibhautika, adhidaivika. All the time, if I don't have problems, my neighbor has problems, my neighbor doesn't have problems, the world has problems, and so on and so forth. So sometimes we think, is it really possible? Is happiness only possible in the spiritual world? Can I never be happy here? So this particular verse tells us that even in the embodied state, one can enjoy nectar. Here Srila Prabhupada is giving a very clear explanation that we can become fully transcendental even while in this material body. It's not that, oh, I have to die and go back to the spiritual world and then only I can be happy. This is very clearly describing that slowly and slowly, steadily and steadily, as we keep practicing Krishna consciousness, we can come to full Krishna consciousness, which means we are no longer identifying with the body, we are no longer in bodily consciousness, we are in full Krishna consciousness, which means we are fully and purely in our constitutional position of serving Krishna with full love, full attention, full devotion, and no longer the things of this material world are going to be touching us because we are not on that platform anymore. So advancing in spiritual knowledge, one can become free from the influence of the modes of nature. Now you might say, modes of nature are everywhere. How we can become free? Mode of goodness, mode of passion, mode of ignorance. Sometimes we are up, sometimes we are down, sometimes we are doing good, sometimes we are not so doing so good, we are all up and down. But that's because we are still in the conditioned state. That's because we are still practicing Krishna consciousness. We haven't reached perfection yet. But here, clearly it is said that not only it is possible, it is the desired goal to become free and enjoy true spiritual happiness. Srila Prabhupada is writing over here, but even in this body, he can enjoy spiritual happiness. That means on the spiritual platform, which is the only platform on which we can be truly happy, because we are actually spiritual beings. On the material level, there is happiness, but it is so fleeting. It is so temporary that it isn't really, you know, any source of lasting happiness. It's just a temporary relief from suffering, actually. I'm very hungry and I get a nice meal and I say, feeling so nice. Or I'm very, very thirsty and I get a nice, cool, tall glass of sugarcane juice. This sugarcane juice is so nice. Or I'm very, very tired and I go and catch a nap. And then when I wake up, I feel, I'm so fresh now. I'm feeling rejuvenated now. So like this, all instances where we have felt happy, actually it has been some relief from some distress. But that is not actually real happiness. So what is real happiness? Real happiness is connecting with Krishna. Real happiness is on the spiritual platform. Real happiness doesn't stop. In fact, it slowly starts increasing more, more, more as we become more and more Krishna conscious. And how to gain this increasing happiness is to regain our constitutional position of loving servitorship to Krishna. Devotional service is the key. Krishna himself says, Bhaktya Mam Abhijanati. Let's see verse number 1855. If you can pull that up for us, my dear Srimati. There, Krishna is explaining, only by devotional service am I to be known. Can you understand? Can you get into the mysteries of my existence? So Krishna explains over here that Bhaktya mam abhijanati yavan yaschasmi tatvataha tato mam tatvato jnata vishate tad anantaram. One can understand me as I am, as the Supreme Personality of Godhead only by devotional service. And when one is in full consciousness of me by such devotion, he can enter into the kingdom of God. Purport. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, and his plenary portions cannot be understood by mental speculation, nor can they be understood by the non-devotees. If anyone wants to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he has to take to pure devotional service under the guidance of a pure devotee. Otherwise, the truth of the Supreme Personality of Godhead will always be hidden. So, Krishna himself says in the Bhagavad Gita in chapter 7, I'm not going to reveal myself to everyone. He's not revealed to everyone. He can choose to remain hidden because only by his sweet will and desire will that hiranmayi patrena, the blazing golden effulgence, be removed and we will be able to see Krishna. We cannot force Krishna to make us see him. That's not possible. So when we become more and more firmly situated in transcendental knowledge of Krishna and engage nicely in Krishna's devotional service, let's go back to the verse, Srimati. I want to continue speaking on that. Yeah, and when we understand our position, we start engaging in devotional service and we become firmly situated by virtue of true knowledge, then we are not going to be distracted. We are not going to be dissuaded. We are not going to be discouraged. We are not going to be thwarted by anything that happens because now we have understood, I am Krishna's servant and my only duty is to be engaged in his loving service. So I will do it no matter what. I will engage in his service no matter what. I will chant my rounds no matter what. I will follow my spiritual master's instructions, however difficult it is. And we can see from Srila Prabhupada's own example how difficult it was. We all know how Srila Prabhupada came on the ship with 2 heart attacks. Even getting passage on that ship was such a difficult ordeal. And then he had to muster up support, get a sponsor letter, somehow manage to transport his books, put them on the ship, and then get them over. So many, many hassles, so many, many steps to cross, so many hurdles to be overcome before he even climbed onto the boat. And then the seasickness and the terrible rocking of the boat to and fro all the time. And finally, he thought, this is too much. I'm not going to be able to make it. And then Krishna came in a dream and he was rowing the boat and all the incarnations were there. And Krishna was telling him, don't worry, I'm in charge of the boat. Nothing will happen. And then Srila Prabhupada knew that he's going to make it. Otherwise, it was a very difficult journey. He was very old and not in good health. He had had 2 heart attacks. He didn't have any support. It was a very difficult, arduous journey. But Prabhupada was determined to come and carry out the order of his Guru Maharaj. And even after coming to the US, was it easy? Was it a cakewalk? Not by any means. In fact, more problems. He didn't have a place to live. He didn't have proper food. It was very cold. At the time he arrived, September, it was like autumn, fall season, and just before the start of winter. And then it became very, very, very cold. So many hassles, so many difficulties, no support, no money, no help, no one to talk to even. Srila Prabhupada was all alone. But did he give up? No. He continued. He said, no, this is the order of my Guru Maharaj. Somehow or the other, I must try. So patiently, steadily, carefully, diligently, Srila Prabhupada continued his activities, continued his translations. At one time, even his typewriter was stolen. Someone broke into their room, stole the typewriter, and went away, leaving Prabhupada without a typewriter even to type out his manuscripts. But did Prabhupada give up? No. So similarly, why did Srila Prabhupada have to go through all those things? Because Krishna put his pure devotee to show us, put his pure devotee through all those ordeals and difficulties just to show us that one who is firmly situated never gives up on the order of his Guru Maharaj. He carries out that order no matter how difficult it may be. Look at our own Janakinath Prabhu, how difficult it was to struggle against the cancer. So many chemotherapies, so many radiations, so many surgeries, swallowing 30 pills a day. But Janakinath Prabhu was determined that he's going to somehow or the other try to give Krishna consciousness to each and every person he met, whether it's the doctor or the nurse or the ward boys or the other patients. And he was so enthusiastic to give Krishna consciousness to others that even had a retreat at Bhaktivedanta Center for all the patients of the ward to come and see the deities and experience a day in Krishna consciousness. So he had transcended the problems of birth, death, old age, and their distresses, and was enjoying nectar even in this life, isn't it? Because he had reached the spiritual platform of the spirit soul, and he was completely fixed in the order of Guru Maharaj to preach Krishna consciousness somehow to the fallen conditioned soul. So Krishna reciprocated with him so marvelously. Thousands and thousands of people have been touched by the example of Janakinath and have been very favorably influenced towards Krishna consciousness because of his very sincere efforts, his sweet demeanor, his charming personality, his unbounded enthusiasm, his oceanic smile. It's just, when you think of Janakinath, it's just unbelievable how one person could have so many wonderful transcendental qualities. But that was our Janakinath Prabhu. So the reason I wanted to bring this out was to show us that even though our bodies and minds may be undergoing so many challenges and so many difficulties, we must go on in our Krishna consciousness. And the day will come when we will be able to transcend the body, we will be able to transcend the mind, and we will be situated in our constitutional position of lovingly serving Krishna 24/7. There's another very wonderful instance of a devotee, a great devotee. She was in New Vrindavan. Her name was Mother Kunti. She was one of the early disciples. Her body was racked with cancer too. And people were just amazed at how she's able to maintain her Krishna consciousness, because any other person with that level of cancer would be in such pain. And she was in pain. But because she was so fixed in her Krishna consciousness, she was able to rise above that and not let it affect her Krishna consciousness. She was even preaching, even though her body was almost finished due to the cancer. So what are all these examples there for? They're to show us that we can also, if we follow in the footsteps of these great souls, one day we can also become free from the influence of the modes of nature by advancing in pure spiritual consciousness. And what is that method of advancement? Chant Hare Krishna, read the books, engage in devotional service, follow the instructions of the spiritual master, and perfect our life. A human form of life is meant to become perfect, to become free, and to go back home, back to Krishna, even though it is a very big challenge to us at the moment. We can take courage from the fact that others have gone before us and they have been successful. So why we will not be successful? All we have to do is try our level best. And ultimately, you may say, oh, I don't think I can make it. You know, I may not be so pure. I may not be so fixed. I may have to take birth again. Well, in that case, you will get a better birth. The next birth will either be in a very, very aristocratic family or in a very pious family of devotees, so that you can pick up where you left off. So in whatever situation, there is no loss. In this moment, there is no loss for practicing Krishna consciousness. You can always go on and go on to the next situation where you can be assured that Krishna will situate you nicely so that you can progress more and more and more in your Krishna consciousness and ultimately go back home, back to Krishna, which is what Krishna also wants. Krishna wants us back more than we want to go back. Prabhupada says this many times. So when one is freed from the influence of the modes of nature, he enters into devotional service. So you may say, I'm still in the modes of nature, but I've also engaged in devotional service. What it means over here is pure devotional service. Srila Prabhupada wants us to reach the platform of pure devotional service. What is that beautiful verse? Anya bilashita shunyam, jnana karma anavritam, anukulyena krishnanu, shilanam bhakti uttama. So, all the information is there, all the knowledge is there, all the procedures have been given. What is favorable, what is unfavorable, that has also been explained. In the nectar of instruction, we know utsaha dhairya nischa. Utsaha means patience, enthusiasm. Nischa means patience. Dhairya means determination. All these things are there. And then following in the footsteps of the great souls, carefully following all the rules and regulations and avoiding the association of non-devotees, all these things will take us to the platform of pure devotional service, little by little by little. So we have to take great solace in the fact that Prabhupada has come, our spiritual masters are there, and we can engage in the process of devotional service. And little by little, we will find ourselves becoming less and less affected by the material energy and becoming more and more situated and fixed in our Krishna consciousness, which is what we really want. We don't want to be subjected to the lashings of Maya after coming to Krishna consciousness. And we can become strong in our Krishna consciousness by our chanting. Investing in quality chanting first thing in the morning during the early morning hours is actually very beneficial for us, because when we chant our rounds with attention, with devotion, we put on our spiritual armor, so to speak, for the whole day. Our intelligence gets purified, our minds get sharpened, and we are able to carry out the duties, responsibilities, tasks, all the things we have to do in good consciousness. And so we make less mistakes, we are less prone to making errors, we are less prone to feeling stressed or reacting even if something negative is happening, because we have armed ourselves with the strength of the holy name. Remember, the holy name will purify us, protect us, and guide us on our path back home, back to Krishna. So we have this very wonderful process of Krishna consciousness. And I thought it's important to remind ourselves that one day we can be free. It may seem difficult at the moment, or it may seem even impossible at the moment, but the hope is there that one day we can be free and we can be truly happy in our Krishna consciousness. So I would like to stop at this point and open up for questions, comments, discussion.
Hare Krishna Mataji, thank you so much. Very nice class. You explained nicely how we are very much conditioned and influence in the mode of influence of the modes of material nature, and how we are not able to be happy while we are chanting. That's true, Mataji. It's on the mind, like you have to chant. But sometimes we will not get that bliss because we are thinking a lot of many other things while chanting and not attentive chanting. So a lot of things, Mataji. Thank you so much. Devotees, if you have any questions or comments, please go ahead.
Haribol, Anuradha. I can see my sister Anuradha. Hare Krishna. These are my humble obeisances. All glories to Prabhupada. All glories to our Gurudev. It would be nice to see everyone. If you can turn on your cameras, that would be really helpful.
Please be please turn on your cameras if possible.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol. Hare Krishna. How are you doing, my dear Anuradha?
Yeah, it's very challenging, but I am in very good place. I'm in Radhadash, so I am having a good time here. And yeah, I was wanting to tell, I have a comment on what you were saying. I was listening, and I really appreciate when you say that how certain devotees shows us with example that can be such a difficult situation, but with the right attitude, we can overcome, like if we really take shelter of Krishna, even if it's so difficult, like in the case of Janakinath Prabhu or Prabhupada, that's how we can always, no matter that how difficult it is for us situation or taking shelter of Krishna, Krishna will take care of us, like, I really appreciate that. So
thank you. Thank you very much. Who else?
There are some examples for us. Even if we get born again, we have a chance to develop Krishna consciousness and move on. So it's always good opportunity for every soul. Yeah. Thank you for encouraging words.
Hare Bol. Thank you, Anuradha. Hare Krishna. My humble obeisances.
Mataji, I was thinking when you gave the example of Janakinath Prabhu, how he used to spread Krishna consciousness even in his state. So in that difficult state also. And we usually have a conscious, we have faith in Guru Maharaj's words and Srila Prabhupada's instructions and everything. We always have faith and we follow Krishna consciousness. But sometimes we hesitate to spread Krishna consciousness or give it to others, whether how they will take or not, or how they will see us. Like a lot of inhibitions we have, and sometimes we don't give Krishna consciousness boldly to other people outside. So how to overcome that nature, Mataji? Like sometimes I hesitate a lot, but sometimes I feel like I have to give and I'll share, but sometimes I hesitate a lot. So how to come out of that nature, Mataji? Can you give any practical tips?
Yeah, well, you know, by constantly remembering that no matter what the situation, ultimately we are just servants of Krishna. So whatever we are doing to please Krishna, to serve Krishna nicely. So even if the venue changes or the people around us change or whatever it is, our position is the same. What am I? I'm servant of Krishna. So when we keep that mood that I'm going to serve Krishna no matter what, then Krishna opens up channels, he opens up opportunities, he makes things happen that we would not be able to do on our own, actually. And then our enthusiasm increases even more to do more for Krishna. So when we do just a little bit sincerely, Krishna reciprocates so much that we feel very encouraged and enthused to go on and to do even more than we did before, you see? So don't get discouraged that sometimes, you know, people may not respond very nicely, or they may be cold, or they may be, you know, impolite or something like that. We just shrug our shoulders and say, oh, all right, I'll try somewhere else. That's all. What to do? Because not every time you're going to have a receptive audience, not every time people are going to be nice. What does Krishna say? Karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachina ma karma phala hetur bhur ma te swango swakarmani. What does that mean? You have a right to perform your prescribed duty, but you are not entitled to the fruits of the action. Never consider yourself to be the cause of the results of your activities, and never be attached to not doing your duty. So we don't get, you know, like carried away. Oh, I gave 15,000 books, or oh, because of me, this person got a plate of prasadam or this or that. We understand that Krishna is the doer. I simply happen to be the right in the right place at the right time, and I'm the right person to do the job. But if I were not here, Krishna would arrange for that person to get that plate of prasadam through some other devotee. So it's not about me. You know, I'm not the great man over here distributing so many books and doing so much seva. It's not about me. Spiritual life is all about Krishna anyway. So we learn to become detached from the results. Someday we might give 5 books. Someday we might give 500 books. What to do? You know, that's just how it is. Nature's laws and the situation changes. It's so fluid. You know, material nature is so changeable that anything can happen. So we don't put so much emphasis on. Just today Guru Maharaj was actually saying Krishna is not so attached to the service as the mood in which it is done. So therefore, a little humble devotee who's just washing pots every day but doing it with great enthusiasm and love for Krishna is as pleasing as that big book distributor who's giving 1,000 books a day, you know, and making big name or fame or whatever it is to Krishna, because Krishna is seeing everything. That little pot washer is as valuable, and his or her service is as dear to him as the person who's distributing books, because in Krishna consciousness, nothing is higher or nothing is lower, you know. Even a simple, humble service is so much appreciated by Krishna if it's done with love and devotion. Patram pushpam phalam toyam yo me bhaktya prayachati tadaham bhakta uparitam ashnami prayatatmanaha. If one offers me with love and devotion a leaf, a flower, a fruit, or water, I will accept it. So Krishna is looking for love, actually, more than anything else. He's not looking for big, big book distribution, big, big building, big, big temple. He wants to see, how is my devotee serving me? Is he thinking of me? Is he wanting to do this to please me? Or is he trying to get a name for himself? Because we are mixed, you know? We are on the mixed platform. So how much for me? How much for Krishna? Like that. So of course we want to be pure. So we want to do more and more for Krishna, and it's less and less about me. But we are in the shower, you know, we're all trying. So we try to do the best we can. So don't get discouraged. Sometimes, you know, we may not be feeling so enthusiastic about something, but still we go on doing whatever our little duties are for the day. We just carry out. Krishna loves it when we become steady in our devotional service. So we are aiming for steadiness, for nishtha, not ups and downs, you know, one day yes, one day no, not like that. We want to become steady in our devotional service. Whatever little bit we do it every day, no matter what. That's what we are aiming for.
Yes, Mataji. Yes, thank you so much, Mataji. And when you say that karmanye vadikaraste, so the thing is, I know that we should not expect results. We have to leave results to Krishna. But mind doesn't remember that. It immediately, if I think of doing anything, immediately I'll think of the result, whether it will be positive or negative or what will be that. So I have to train my mind, first of all, to do that. Like, don't expect results. Just do your work. So thank you so much, Mataji.
We don't do things blindly and intelligently. Yeah. Is supposed to contemplate what will be the result of my action, how will this you know, come out, and so on. We are not dissuaded from planning intelligently or doing things intelligently. What Krishna wants detachment from is being attached to the desire for a certain particular outcome to happen. Mm-hmm. I must distribute 100 books today, or I must make 50 plates of prasadam today, and if I don't do, then I'm a bad devotee, or I'm no good devotee. This kind of thinking is not helpful for us, because it's not about me anyway.
Mm.
It's about pleasing Krishna. So Krishna is pleased by the quality of the service. He's not seeing the quantity or numbers. He's not in the numbers game, you know. Mm. Krishna wants our love, and he wants everything done nicely in the mood of devotion to him. like that.
Yeah. Yes, Mataji. Now I understood. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Devotees, anybody have any more questions or comments?
It's really late in the night for Namrata. What is it? It's what, 10:30, 11?
Yeah.
10:15. About to be 10:15.
Wow. Dedication. That's your middle name. Namrata, Mrs. Dedication. Guru Maharaj loves it. So steady on the call.
Actually, Mataji, I think this is the steady association also I'm getting in return. So I'm ready for that. I can just say that.
Hare Krishna.
I love that. Just a small thing to share, Mataji. Sometimes it happens that I'm not able to wake up for the chanting in the morning time. So, you know, it's always a struggle. If you miss the morning time, it's always a struggle to, you know, adjust your japa time in the entire day.
Yes.
And if in case, I try to manage if I miss the morning time. But if in case there is some workload or something and my japas are I'm not able to complete, I really feel, you know, either I get disturbed or I feel guilty, or I'm not able to finish my japa today. So what should I do for this thing? Should I keep the morning time only my target, or is it okay if sometimes you can adjust in the daytime?
What do you think?
I think for me morning time is more better, because you know you can meditate more accurately. But actually I feel sometimes I have been contemplating on this thing. And I have heard certain lectures, and I found out that somewhere deep within you, you're lacking the the want for that japa. I mean, for the harina. So you know, you don't give priority to that thing. So subtly, maybe this thing is working. I'm not sure, but
yeah, that can happen. You know, the mind can play tricks on you that, oh, this is not so important. Sleep over. It's okay. Your body is very tired now. No need to get up so soon. You can always catch up during the rest of the day, and so on. And mind plays so many tricks on us, you know. And we all go through phases where mind is telling us, no need to get up to chant now, go sleep, you need the extra rest, you worked so hard the previous day, or you had a very late night, and this and that and all. But actually, it may be that you may need to rest, because what's the point if you're getting up tired and worn out, and you're checking around, you know, half sleeping. It may be that it's much better to get fully rested and then chant your rounds. You know, Thakur does say that if one is extremely tired, then better to sleep, get some rest, and then continue chanting after waking up. That might be, I'm tired today. And it's been a very long day also. So sometimes we need to make some adjustments. So we should be flexible about that. But at the same time, we must have some kind of established routine so that every day it's not question mark. When we chant? When will I chant? When will I chant? Like that.
Yeah, exactly. I think I want to stay fixed on one time, and you know.
Yeah, the best time is the Brahma Muhurta hours, you know, 1.5 hours before sunrise is the best hours for chanting. And early morning chanting, boy, there's just no comparison to that, you know. When you wake up early and you chant early morning rounds, nothing compares to that. Really, it's a giving best gift if you can wake up early. Early is the best gift you can give you. And as you do that more, you will see for yourself the value of doing that. In the beginning, I remember in Krishna consciousness, I wasn't able to rise early in the morning and do all that stuff. I would rise, you know, maybe just in time for darshanarthi or something like that. And then obviously whole day on is chasing rounds. But I began to see the value of it, because once in a blue moon, when I would actually get up for Mangalarati, maybe it was Ekadashi that day or some very big, you know, something, and then I would make the attempt, and when I would chant early morning, I would see how much difference it made. Then I started getting interested in waking up early, and so little by little, the desire Mangalarti or to wake up early, it came. It wasn't there in the beginning. So don't worry. As long as you're making an effort, Krishna will help. So don't beat yourself up if you're not able to do it right away. Just go on. Just keep chanting. And slowly, slowly, you will find yourself getting more and more attracted to chanting better.
Yes, Mataji. I think, yeah, I'll do that.
Okay.
Thank you for giving a concerning word that it's okay to be flexible sometimes.
Yes, yes. Especially when we have kids and home and all that stuff. We can't is, you know, hold to a certain time. We may have to be flexible and do some other thing first. What if your child is very hungry and he's saying, mommy, make some idlis or dosas or something for me. Then you have to stop everything and cook something nice for your kid because he's hungry. That comes first. You can always, you know, chant afterwards. Like that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mataji.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Devotees, there are no more questions. I think we can end the call here. Still 10 more minutes is there for our, so... Swaha Mataji, Vishwa Pavani Mataji, or Lakshmi Mataji, Madhavananda Prabhu, anybody wants to say anything?
Hare Krishna. No, I don't have any further comments. Just I can relate to not being able to wake up very early in the morning. You know, you have to work as well. So. But I try to do it at the weekend. So, but it is really, really, you're right. When you manage to get up early, it's so much nicer. And you can just feel the bliss. But I do it, you know, I put my Apple TV on and I do it with ISKCON London. So we're chanting with the devotees like that, but online. So that's the sort of routine. Yeah, I definitely agree with Sri Devi, Mataji, and yourself that Maharaj says it every time, practically on every lecture, that chant your rounds before breakfast. So that is my, I think that's going to be my New Year's resolution to try that.
Thank you so much, my dear.
Okay. So Mataji, shall we stop here? I think there are no questions or comments. Yeah.
Yeah, we can stop over here.
Yeah, thank you so much, everyone, for participating. Namrata Mataji, you want to say anything?
Yeah, just one thing, if I can ask from yesterday, what Maharaj was talking about. He said in one statement that sometimes people have personality conflict. It has nothing to do with the situation. So if you may reflect something or enlighten us or elaborate a little, I wanted to know how to understand this better.
I think it's best that you ask this question to Guru Maharaj because I don't know what context he said it in, and I also don't know so much about it. So it's best if you ask Guru Maharaj, because he will give you the complete answer and you'll have full clarity.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Okay, Mataji, thank you so much. So we'll end the call here. If there are no more questions.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, everyone. Vancha Kalpata Rupyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhavacha.
Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Jai Hare Krishna. Jai
Prabhupada Ki Jai.
Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai.
Guru Maharaj Ki Jai.
Ki Jai.